We're talking to Jeff Fenech all the way from Australia. Jeff, recently I saw this post. Who are the four faces? If you had to put four faces on a mountain, Mount Rushmore or boxing, who for you are the four faces of the sport? Who do you go with?
For me, you would have to go with the people that who people want to see, or who people are gonna pay to go and see those mountains. Mike Tyson's got to be one. I mean, I love Joe Louis. I think Joe Louis was the most technically perfect heavyweight of all time. But I mean, you know, but
was champ for 12 years, right?
Like I said, when you watch this guy throw punches back then, they're perfect. That's what you teach people to do today. That he was just perfect at his trade. But you know, I'd put Ray Leonard up there for sure, and I'd most probably put Roberto Duran.
Those are top four. It was amazing. I noticed.
And like I said, I love Julio Cesar Chavez. I mean, when I watch him, because I love Roberto so much, I think, wow, who would have won that fight? What a great fight that would have been, you know. But Chavez at his best was like just awesome, you know. When you watch those fights with Meldrew Taylor, and you've got to realize because he beat him, people don't give Taylor enough credit. Meldrew Taylor was such a gifted athlete, such a great puncher, such great speed, and Chavez beat him.
That was a crazy fight. So
yeah, even the first one with the controversy wasn't the greatest thing to watch. But look, man, you know, the referee looked after the fighter, and that's all we can say. But the second fight, wow, Chavez was awesome.
Jeff, you fought in three different weight classes. If you had to come back to boxing, which weight class would you want to compete in today?
I would love to compete in the featherweight division.
126. You have a lot of big names there. Gary Russell, Leo Santa Cruz. Obviously, Lomachenko was there but moved up. You would have loved to compete against the guys today. How do you think you would do?
I'll fight anybody. I'm not worried about anybody. Like I said, Jeff Harding, the light heavyweight champion, was my sparring partner every day. I sparred with guys that were light heavyweights and stuff every single day. I sparred Justin Fortune. I sparred all those guys.
Shout out to Justin, by the way.
Yeah, Justin's my great friend. I want to thank him for just letting me use his gym while Brock and I were in Los Angeles. His new gym is beautiful, and the Fortune gym. So, yeah. But, yeah, so, look, for me, of course, we all say the same thing. I thought I'd have no problem with any of them.
But Jeff, you said you sparred heavyweights. You were a 126-pounder. Why is so dangerous? Because even if they go easy, which nobody ever goes easy, and they say, well, let's go easy in sparring.
Nobody went easy at our gym. We sparred full on. Yeah, I sparred Jeff Harding 10 rounds at a time, 8 rounds at a time, you know, when he was the light heavyweight champion of the world. I mean, I sparred Matthew Saad Muhammad, after he sparred, he said it's most probably the hardest spar he's ever had. And he was a great. You know, I sparred Greg Howard. I sparred all those guys. I sparred Roger Mayweather.
How was that? By the way, rest in peace, Roger. He just passed away.
Yeah.
What was that being, sharing the ring with the Black Mamba?
Yeah, it was amazing for me. I was just over getting an award in Vegas, and we went past the gym, and we organized with my Olympic coach, Ed Wishes, to go back the next day and spar him. It was an amazing experience for me. But like I said, I had no problem, sparring the bigger guys. And like I said, when I think of myself, of course I think that I could have beaten them all. That's if I didn't think that, I wouldn't be a fighter. I wouldn't have had the success I had. But like I said, I watched today, and like I said, I'm respected by the likes of Evander. Evander knows what I could do. The last time I was with Evander said Jeff Fenech could be just the toughest little guy that ever fought. To get that compliment from Evander Holyfield is a huge compliment. So, like I said, I know what I could do.
Mayweather started training again. He started sparring again. To me, it says he may come back. And I don't know if it's Pacquiao. I don't know if it's an MMA fighter. I don't know if it's exhibition. Mayweather, if he has a rematch with Manny Pacquiao, what do you think? Manny's a champion right now, 147. Mayweather's been retired since 2017, I think.
I'm going to give you the greatest bit of advice I can ever give anyone, because I love what you do for our sport. Styles make fights. Styles. Look. Go through the great four. Leonard, Hagler, Hearns, and Duran gets knocked out by Hearns, but Hearns beats Barkley, but Roberto beats styles, you know. So, Floyd's style is so unique, and he's so great at his style. Floyd is just amazing. So, I mean, look, I don't care if Floyd's 55, that his style is always going to be difficult for Manny.
It's like someone says in mathematics, 3 and 2 is 5, 2 and 3 is 5. But in boxing, it doesn't work like that. Just because one beat one doesn't mean he would beat...
That's exactly right, man. And that's what people are going to think. Just stole... Listen, I want to say something because I loved Emmanuel Stewart again. Emmanuel Stewart told me, and I'm, this, I'm not going to... So, but Emmanuel said to me, with Tommy, he said, Jeff, there were certain guys that I would never let Tommy fight, as great as he was, because I just thought that Tommy had... He knew exactly what Tommy did. And he said, the times I let him fight and he got beaten, I let him fight because I got him millions and millions of dollars. And also, I wouldn't have even taken those fights either. So, and yeah, like I said, Manuel Stewart knew about styles and what were the styles that were great for his fighters. And that's why I think he was such a great fighter, that great trainer. And he wasn't a trainer, he was a teacher. He taught things. You watch when Manny does pads, Elie, he doesn't catch punches. He actually... acts as if he is the opponent. So you'll see him fall a couple of times and faint. But that's what pad work's supposed to be. All these guys who do pad work today and push the pad towards your opponent, that doesn't happen in a fight. We don't, your opponent don't headbutt your punches.
That's true. No, but people don't think that. They also, fighters should train with the mouthpiece because sometimes it's uncomfortable. Get used to it. Train with the cup on. Because these are small things you don't train with and then comes fight night, you're not used to it.
Definitely so. Like I said, all these guys who you see doing pads and doing all these basketball. Hey, look, let me give an example. Please, you look and get back to me on this one. Go and look at Floyd. Look at all those crazy combinations that he done on the pads. He never done one of them in a fight. Floyd made you miss, he made you pay. He was great. He made you miss, he made you pay. One, two punches at a time. It was never a 10 or 12 punch combination. It was just, yeah, he was just so clever. He bamboozled everybody with his workouts on the pads because Roger was doing 80% of the work. When it came to fight time, Floyd knew exactly what to do. Floyd is a freak. Floyd is a freak in the boxing. He just knows exactly the distance to be. You know, listen, when people say who, Floyd beat everybody that could fight, Arturo Gatti, Angel Man,
Castillo, Corrales.
Yeah, Corrales. I mean, he didn't just beat him. He whipped their asses because, you know why?
Ricky Hatton.
He had their measure. Ricky Hatton, oh, what a great fight Ricky was. Like he beat Costa Zoo, you know. So what I'm saying, yeah, so Floyd, don't worry about Floyd. Floyd knows exactly what to do. He watches his opponent. I've never seen anybody read a fight better than Floyd Mayweather.
He's a genius at the sport, and he's very good at making money. You have to respect him. And I'll tell you something about Floyd, and you could tell me if the same thing is about Mike Tyson. Floyd has a persona. Turn off the camera, be alone with him. He's the nicest person. Very generous. When I told him some fighter passed away and nobody would pay for the guy's funeral, Floyd came through. And these are things that it's not for the camera, it's not for an interview, he's just a good person.
He doesn't want nobody to know. That's the same as Mike. I was on a plane with Mike Tyson. I went to sit down in business class with him, where we were in first class. I fell asleep and I woke up. I'm sitting near an old lady. He went and put an old lady in his seat, went to the back of the plane. Yeah, people don't know. He hasn't done that for me to tell anybody. But I want to tell it. Say what you want to tell about. You know why I love Floyd Mayweather so much? Because Floyd's this. Floyd said this, and you can never get better than this. Listen, this is Floyd Mayweather. This is who I am. I want you to love me or like me or hate me for who I am. I don't want you to find out later that everything I've told you is BS, and you know, then you think, oh, wait, I'm fake. He's not fake. He's a real man. That's Floyd Mayweather. I take my hat off to you, man. I love you very much, and you're one of the greatest fighters that ever lived.
It's funny you say that. I covered the NBA for 10 years. The basketball players in the NBA with the worst reputation were the nicest guys, would give the shirt off the back. The guys with the perfect image were the guys you would never want to be around. Jeff, you wouldn't want to be around them. They just weren't pleasant. But the image...
They're putting up a false image. Floyd, let's know who he is. You either like me, this is Floyd. This is who I am. You either like me or don't like me. I don't care if you like me, but this is who I am. You can't like anybody more than that. You can't give anybody more than 100 out of 100 for that, mate.
When you were around Mike and people came to the gym, did anybody ever come to him and say, hey, I need help with this, I need help with that, and he's like, okay, I got it?
No, always. He was always helping people. Mike was always helping people.
Like what?
Mike's Mike. I mean, we'd walk into one of those restaurants in LA and you'd have those people outside selling flowers. I'd see Mike, give him a couple $100, and this, don't drive people mad, they just go home. Same as we'd be driving up the street to go to the house, he'd see some people on the side of the road, he would just stop, give them some money and tell them to go home. Nobody told him to stop the car. I didn't notice anything. I'm busy talking, but that was just Mike, you know. And I know Floyd's very, very similar. I remember being away on a couple of trips with Floyd being there and talking to him. And when I got home, I always thought, wow, what a loyal friend that guy would be. You know, that's Floyd, and that's Mike to me. And Mike is very, very loyal to me. And I mean, I know that Floyd has said things that people aren't happy about, but guess what? He said them. He didn't hold it in. He said what he felt, and that's why I love him so much. I mean, that's what he thinks. That's up to him, you know? So I just know he's a great man.
I read something recently about someone says you have to always say the truth. Even if people don't agree with you, at least it's your truth. Because you could say the popular thing, but you're not telling them the real thing. Just because it's everybody's in the bandwagon of criticizing, let's say me, ES News, this. But it's just because it's cool to say, but privately, oh, we support you. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, of course. Like I said, I'm blessed to even be talking today. I understand. I'm here in Australia, it's a long way. But like I said, for me, if it's black, it's black. And if it's white, it's white. I'm just going to tell the truth.
So, a couple more questions.
Yeah, I don't want to sugarcoat things or hide things. I just tell the truth.